Hello and welcome everyone to this time of worship and sharing together. Firstly, a word of scripture. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God. And let us pray. Father, we thank you that your mercies are new every morning and your faithfulness is great. Empower us to sing the song of your great love, even when we must sing it through our tears. In our own challenging times, may we join the psalmists with singing a revolution for our hearts. Now let us join together in singing In Christ Alone, a special recording made by the National Methodist Choir in Britain. I hope you enjoy it.
In Christ alone, my hope is found.
He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still.
Thank you.
The reading is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. The Walk to Emmaus. On that same day, two of Jesus' followers were going to a village named Emmaus, about 11 kilometers from Jerusalem. And they were talking to each other about all the things that had happened. As they talked and discussed, Jesus himself drew near and walked along with them. They saw him, but somehow did not recognize him. Jesus said to them, "What are you talking about to each other as you walk along?" They stood still with sad faces. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have been happening there these past few days?" "What things?" he asked. "The things that happened to Jesus of Nazareth," they answered. "This man was a prophet and was considered by God and by all the people to be powerful in everything he said and did. Our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and he was crucified. And we had hoped that he would be the one who was going to set Israel free. Besides all that, this is now the third day since it happened. Some of the women of our group surprised us. They went at dawn to the tomb, but could not find his body. They came back saying they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he is alive. Some of our group went to the tomb and found it exactly as the women had said, but they did not see him also. Then Jesus said to them, 'How foolish you are! How slow you are to believe everything the prophet said. Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and then to enter his glory?' And Jesus explained to them what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning with the books of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further. But they held him back, saying, 'Stay with us. The day is almost over, and it is getting dark.' So he went in to stay with them. He sat down to eat with them, took the bread, and said the blessing. Then he broke the bread and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, 'Wasn't it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?' They got up at once and went back to Jerusalem, where they found the 11 disciples gathered together with the others and saying, 'The Lord is risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon.' The two then explained to them what had happened on the road and how they had recognized the Lord when he broke the bread." Amen.
Hello, good morning. When we last met on Easter Sunday, we looked at Luke's Gospel and Luke's account in chapter 24 of how the women went to the tomb on the first day of the week. And when they got there, they found the tomb empty, the stone rolled away, and two men who had the appearance of shining apparel. And they said to the women, "Why are you looking for the living amongst the dead? He's not here, he's risen." And later they went and told the disciples, and Peter himself came to the tomb and found it just as the women said. We carry on the story now from verse 13 and the story of the road to Emmaus. There were two disciples going there. One we know is Cleopas. We don't know the name of the other disciple. Emmaus is about 7.5 miles from Jerusalem. It's not a particularly important town. We're not even sure where it is today. Why were they going there? Perhaps it's where they came from, or where they had their lodging, or no other special reason why they were making their way there. But as they're going along the way, they're talking excitedly about all the things that happened. And the stranger comes alongside them. Nothing unusual there. It was dangerous to travel alone in those days, and maybe people would latch on to groups for safety. "What are you talking about?" says the stranger. Disciples stop and are sad. In the words of the late Eddie Large, they stood back in amazement. "Where have you been?" they said. "Don't you know about Jesus and what's been going on? We thought he was the Messiah. But the leaders took him and handed him over to the Romans, and he was crucified and laid in a tomb. And this is 3 days since this happened. And some of the women in our number, they went down to the tomb this morning and reported that it was empty. And all they saw were some angels who told them that he wasn't there, that he'd risen from the dead." "How foolish you are and slow to believe," said the stranger. "Doesn't the scripture tell you that the Messiah must be crucified and then rise again from the third day? And the stranger began to explain to them all the things it said in the Old Testament concerning Jesus, how he must suffer and rise again from the dead. Eventually they came to the town, and the stranger made that he was going to go further. I don't know how many sermons there have been about that text. But the man was persuaded to stay with them. And he went in and he broke the bread and he blessed it. And as soon as that happened, they realised it was Jesus. But then he disappeared. Now, what would you do in those circumstances? Well, they decided they'd better hot-foot it back to Jerusalem and tell everybody what they'd seen. "Didn't our heart burn within us," they said, "when we heard him explaining the scriptures to us?" So they go back to Jerusalem and they discover that Jesus has appeared to Peter, and they explain to them all that they'd seen and how Jesus had been known to them when he'd broken the bread. I think the story of the road to Emmaus is one of my favourite stories in the appearances that Jesus made. People might ask, well, why didn't they recognise him? Well, perhaps the glorified Jesus didn't quite look the same. Or maybe he had a mask over his face, like many people are now, this time to keep the dust out of their faces. Or maybe just as their hearts were unable to recognise what the Old Testament said about Jesus, he was hidden from their sight until he opened their hearts. We talk, don't we, about people having a Damascus Road experience. And what do we mean by that? When we remember how Paul had gone to persecute the church and he met the living Lord on the road to Damascus. And he was blinded until a disciple called Ananias went and healed him. And he then did a 180-degree turn. And instead of persecuting the church, he became the church's greatest champion. Now, most of us don't feel that way about Jesus. We're not particularly against him. But we're not sure about who he is and what he stands for. Is he a good man? Is he a teacher? Maybe he's somebody who's a social advocate. We just don't know. but maybe we need to have a road to Emmaus experience where God opens our understanding and we see him as he really is, the risen Saviour. My prayer for all of us this morning is that we too would have an Emmaus experience, that our hearts would burn within us as we understand what the scripture has to say about him, and that we'd come to know him as our risen Lord and experience his transforming power. Thanks very much for listening. Have a good day. Amen.
Sometimes it can be hard, particularly at the moment, to really feel that God is with us and around us. But some of our friends have recorded some messages of where they have felt God has been close to them.
Hello everyone. Hope you're all keeping well. Fred and I are okay, keeping busy, looking for all these jobs to do. We like to go out for our walk in the morning when it's early. We're very fortunate that 5 minutes from home and we can be out in the countryside, listening to the birds and sun shining, watching the crops grow. It's lovely to be out there. I think possibly that's when Fred and I feel closest to God. We do get a sense of peace, and it's great to know that he's there looking out for us all. Anyway, keep safe everybody. Take care. God bless. Lots of love. Bye.
Just to be in the garden and watching the flowers, they're about to bud and all come out looking beautiful. Hear the buzzing of the bees and the birds tweeting. It's just peaceful with nature. You feel that perhaps God is all around.
Dot here. I do hope you're all right. I'm fine, fed up of being in, but hey ho, you've got to be in, keep safe. I find it's lovely to be when you're doing the coffee, and I always feel closer to God in that. When I'm there, I miss everybody that goes to the cafe. I miss everybody that goes to church. Let's hope that it's all over with soon and then we can all be back together like one big happy family again.
Hello everyone. I hope you're all keeping well. I've been thinking about when and where I feel closest to God and find it very difficult to answer, as he's everywhere I look. In the people, young and old, all around being kind and caring. In magnificent scenery and in the smallest flowers and wildlife. During the past few weeks, I've felt close to God in my garden, noticing the beauty of the small changes each day that happen without my help, and listening to the bird song. I think one of my favourite hymns is, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand has made. It sums it all up for me. Hope you all keep well. Bye for now.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, can sing all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior. Through the deepest valley, He will lead.
Christ in me.
Good day to you all. Sadly, Easter is not always the most popular of Christian celebrations. Firstly, Easter is about a death, a very ugly death. And then Easter is about a very dead man coming back to life. It's about an empty tomb, which many nowadays would ridicule. Indeed, we get the impression that nearly everyone believes that death is very much the end for us all. But recently in The New Scientist, which is an entirely secular periodical, a survey reported on how many Americans actually believe in life after death. The surprising result was that about 96% still believe in life after death in the 21st century, despite all the hype to the contrary. Now, if you ask most Christians about life after death, they would say, we go to heaven. Certainly, the New Testament tells us those who live in a daily relationship with God find that this is not broken by death. Indeed, the relationship is strengthened and they find themselves in his glorious presence. Praise God, hallelujah. I know there are silly cartoons of people in white robes playing harps and sitting on clouds, but these do not do any justice to the biblical picture of heaven, which is a real place where God is enthroned and worshipped by angels and humans alike. Here there is no illness or weakness, no viruses, no wars, no hunger, and it's not damp. But Easter tells us that while all this is true, it's only half the wonderful truth. When the women at the tomb and later the disciples saw Jesus, he was not a ghost. He was not a spirit living on after his body was killed. Jesus had risen from death. Death had worked backwards. He had a warm, living body, which the disciples saw with their eyes and touched with their hands. In the upper room that night, he ate broiled fish with them. This is not just about surviving death by going to be with God in heaven. This is about coming back to life with arms and legs and senses. His body was better than the one he had had when he lived on earth for 30 odd years. His new body, while still a human body, will never die and seems to have powers beyond the merely human. If Jesus had appeared as a ghost, it would have frightened the disciples, but it would not have puzzled them. They thought they knew about ghosts, but a dead man, a very dead man, getting up and being alive and totally healthy, despite his injuries, was a different matter. But that is what they testify happened, despite finding it difficult to believe themselves. So, how does Jesus rising change things for us and our loved ones? It changes everything. John tells us that at the Last Supper, Jesus told his disciples, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I will come back and take you to be with me. But this place was not heaven, which had been there since before creation. No, when Jesus returns, the present heaven and earth will be wound up and done away with, and a new heaven and a new earth, which he is making, will come into being. And on that new earth will be God's people, raised from death as Jesus was raised from death, with new, perfect, warm, healthy, lively bodies. We, you and I, are among God's people to whom this promise is made. And with those wonderful new bodies, we will begin life, eternal life, with God as our leader and guide, and with our fellows as our huge family. Made clean by God, there will be no evil, no crime, no war, and no illness. Made clean by God, there will be joy and peace and love and goodness forever and ever. Certainly, until that time, we go to be with God when we die. But one day, we move on to the perfect kingdom. We are raised back to life. The kingdom that Jesus is even now getting ready for us, for me and for you. Be comforted that whatever happens to us in these strange and worrying times, in the end, God has prepared a life for us all. This is wonderful, beyond our imagining. Amen.
Now Merle is going to lead us in our prayers for others and for ourselves. And following that, we will all join together with the Lord's Prayer, which will be led by Bronte, Anastasia and Hannah. Thank you.
Good morning. I invite you to join with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning we are gathered in our own homes, but yet still connected to each other through the act of prayer. We know, Father, that whenever and wherever we say our prayers, that you hear them, and that you will always care for us, guiding and supporting us, even through this pandemic. We pray about our loved ones, who we are concerned and worried about. By necessity, we are separated from friends and neighbours, and are thankful that even now we are finding ways of keeping in touch. It is good, Lord, that we have been able to join in virtual services like this one, Zoom prayer meetings, and Sunday services on television and radio. We pray for those in hospital at this time, family, neighbours or friends. We remember those in hospital not just because of coronavirus, but mothers giving birth in hospital, those whose cancer treatment has been delayed, and others who may have had a fall resulting in a stay in hospital. We pray for all nurses, doctors and ancillary staff, not forgetting those working in care homes at this desperately worrying time. We pray for those nurses and doctors who have died whilst caring for others, and we ask your loving care for their families. We pray for our government in their unenviable task of keeping us all safe and protected. We pray that supplies of PPE will improve, and that none will be put at risk in order to care for patients without proper protection. We pray too for the millions across the world and here at home suffering great financial hardship because of this pandemic, and all those worrying day by day about paying their bills and putting food on the table. Lastly, Lord, we pray for ourselves. We pray for your help, that we will hold on tight to the hope that came to us at Easter through the death and resurrection of Jesus. We thank you for the gift of new life that you offer freely to all who simply believe in you. We pray for those who feel lost and afraid, that they will look to you for help. We believe that anyone who reaches out to you will never be turned away, because you are a compassionate God whose love conquers all. We pray that as we step into a new week of lockdown, that the infection rates will reduce and that more people will recover from this virus. We pray these prayers in the name of Jesus, our friend, our Saviour, and our Lord. Amen.
Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
My Father, there is no shadow.
we finish this time of worship together, I would just like to thank all those people who have contributed to this time of worship. It has been lovely to see and hear so many of you. Let us join together in saying the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.